Penguin Random House Audio presents Dead Man's Hand by James J. Butcher. Read for you by James Patrick Cronin. This book is dedicated to good fathers, both those whom we are fortunate enough to have with us and those whom we would give anything to have with us again. Prologue. Leslie Mayflower glowered out between the dusty blinds of his darkened living room, watching the street. The morning sun made him squint his bleary eyes, bringing forth a pounding in the back of his head. He wasn't sure which to curse harder, the sun or the empty bottle of whiskey in his grip. Or maybe the other empty bottle on the couch behind him, or perhaps the broken one he'd thrown against the fridge the night before. It was simpler to just curse himself. The phone rang, brash and blaring. He hardly recognized the sound. The assault on his head redoubled, but at least he was certain what to curse above all else. He pawed at the receiver without taking his eyes from the window. The bass fell to the floor and he left it there. He held the plastic handset to his ear. "Yeah," his voice croaked. He couldn't remember how many days it had been since he'd last spoken. "Damien Greaves calling for Les Mayflower, please." The voice was calm and authoritative, and familiar. "Bastard," Mayflower growled. "Ah, it is you," Greaves replied. "Not interested. Les, just listen." Mayflower didn't listen. He dropped the handset and stomped on the bass until the tinny sound stopped. He turned his attention to what really mattered. Across the street, Sarah was pruning her roses. The kids were at school for the day, and she had Thursdays off. She usually spent her days off in her garden, enjoying the empty street until the rest of the neighborhood returned in the afternoon. He sometimes watched her live her quiet morning out, peacefully, and found something like peace in that for himself. The front pocket of his flannel robe began to buzz, and he twitched his stance a few inches wider on instinct. He grunted and withdrew his confounded cell phone from his pocket, glaring at the small screen on the front. It read simply, "Unknown." "Unknown my ass," he said. He snarled and snapped the phone open. "Go to hell." He swigged one last time from his whiskey bottle, receiving only a couple of drops for his trouble. He sat it alongside the others that lined his coffee table and opened the front door. He went outside, his passage disturbing countless days of accumulated dust, which swirled in the blinding beams that poured into his house. "Mayflower, please," Greaves said, his voice smaller and more static on the old cell. "It's important." The sun seemed very upset that Mayflower had left his hideout, redoubling its efforts to split his head in two from front to back. He focused his annoyance on Greaves. "I'm in the middle of something," he lied. "It can wait. You don't know that. Whatever it is, it can wait. I've got something bigger." "Handle it yourself. I'm retired." He made as though he was inspecting the stability of his paint-peeled picket fence. He confirmed it was just as rickety as the letters he consistently received from his neighborhood association of asshats claimed. "Men like us can't retire, you know that." Mayflower stopped cold. He felt his teeth grind and his old heart begin to thrum. Not faster, but harder, like it was suddenly wrapped in taut wires. The pumping blood made his muscles tense and ache. "Men like us," he said, his voice a whisper. "You and I are nothing alike, witch." "I disagree. Go to hell, Greaves." He snapped the phone shut and popped out the battery, shoving them both back into the pocket of his robe. Across the street, Sarah looked up and saw him. She smiled beneath the wide brim of her sun hat and waved a dirt-stained glove at him. He managed a tight-lipped smile back, but his stomach twisted and he retreated into the dark of his hollow home. He shut the door behind him and leaned back against it. He growled, ripped a cigarette from the crumpled pack in his robe pocket and lit it, drawing in a deep breath of scorching heat. He held the smoke in his chest for a moment before letting it slip out, then went toward his diminishing liquor cabinet to fetch a new bottle of whiskey. He stopped in front of the fridge, his feet crunching on broken glass from the bottle he had smashed against it last night. The icebox was a blank white canvas, save for a single sun-bleached sticky note at its center. The adhesive had long since failed, so he had used a magnet to keep it in place. The magnet covered up the top half, but the bottom read, "Take care of yourself," in a painfully familiar and feminine hand. He read it, over and over again. Then he took a deep breath and ground the cigarette out on the heel of his palm. It hurt, and all he could think was, "Good." He put the cigarette back in the pack, got out the broom, and swept up the broken glass. He started toward the liquor cabinet again before stopping himself. "Hydrate, idiot," he croaked at himself. He filled a tall cup with water from the sink and forced himself to down the whole thing. Then, and only then, did he go to the liquor cabinet and withdraw his second-to-last bottle of whiskey. He cracked it open and took a swig before he settled back in at the window. There was little else to do but watch the day slip away. Just then the sound of an engine came. It wasn't the throaty rumble of the old mail truck that patrolled the neighborhood, nor the quiet rush of the usual suburban sedans. It was smooth and quiet, hardly a whispering breath as it came closer. If the street hadn't been silent, he might never have heard it coming. But he did hear it, and he also recognized it. "Bastard," he growled, slamming the blinds closed until only the thinnest slat of light eked through. He watched the road, waiting. When the car came within sight, he saw it was sleek, black, and mirrorless. Even the windows were imperceptibly dark. It reminded him of a black-shelled beetle. The car slipped down the street slowly, as though studying. Finally, it reached Mayflower's house and pulled into his driveway behind his beat-up tank of a Jeep. A Jeep that could crush the black plastic bug car flat, he noted proudly. The car's door opened and out stepped a man clad in a fine and expensive black suit. He wore a pair of stylish open-rimmed glasses on his hawkish nose. Mayflower spat a curse and took a deep, deep swig from his bottle. "Greaves," he muttered over the burn of the liquor. "You son of a bitch." Greaves walked up to Mayflower's door and knocked in three precisely identical motions. Mayflower thought about not answering, about staying in his darkened living room, glaring out the window until the witch left, but that wouldn't be the end of things. Three more knocks, exactly as the last. "I know you're home, Les. I just called you." "I'm coming," he barked, stomping to the front door and throwing it open. "What are you doing here?" Greaves offered him a polite smile. "I called you while I was on my way. Figured you'd throw a tantrum and hang up on me." "You want to see what a tantrum looks like?" Mayflower asked quietly. Greaves straightened his tie, annoyingly unperturbed by the threat. "I'm not here to fight. I wanted to tell you myself before you found out." He stopped. Something was wrong. "What?" "Samantha is dead." Mayflower heard something shatter at his feet, and he numbly looked down to see it was his bottle of whiskey. He stared at the mess of broken glass and splattered liquor for a long moment before looking back to Greaves. "How?" he asked. In her line of work, it was inevitable, he knew that. But Samantha Mansgraff was tough, the toughest witch he'd ever met, and he'd been half convinced she'd outlive him despite already being his senior by a century or more. "We're not sure yet," Greaves said. "But it was unpleasant." Mayflower's lip curled in a grimace. "How many did she take with her?" Greaves frowned. "Hers was the only body we found." He glared. "That's not right. My people were very thorough. If someone tried to kill Mansgraff, she'd tear their throat out with her teeth. If several people tried, she'd start using her hands." "Well, you know her better than anyone else. Not better than you. You were her student, until you screwed her over." Greaves ignored his comment. "You were her partner," he countered. "She's hardly said a word to me since you quit." "Retired," Mayflower said. "I didn't approve it. Fortunately, I didn't work for you or the department, so your approval was unnecessary." Greaves shrugged and held up his hands in a diffusing gesture. "Fine, fine. In any case, now's not the time for this. Why are you here, Greaves? He asked. To tell you the news. You could have sent a lackey. What are you, department director by now? Greaves twitched a brow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.